Thanks to the organizers for this nice event. It's glad to be here. So yeah, I'm going to follow those notes on the webpage pretty closely, so you can follow from there along the way, if you so please. So what am I going to talk about? I'm going to talk about last passage percolation. And there are roughly three somewhat disjoint topics, but of course closely related. And I'm going to try to divide the lectures among the three topics. So the first one will be on variational formulas for the limit shape. And this will be fairly general. By that I mean that for those who know, it's going to be general distribution on the weights. And then the second two topics will be on exactly solvable stuff. So the second one will be about the stationary corner growth model. So let's say CGM for the corner growth model. So with exponential weights. And Busemann functions. So with the exponential weights, we are firmly in the realm of exactly solvable models. And then the third one will touch upon this KPZ theme. It'll be on fluctuation exponents. And again for the exponential corner growth model. So there'll probably be a fruitful interplay between my lectures and Eric's lectures. We'll see. I don't know exactly what he'll talk about, but I think you'll see some of the same themes from two different sides. All right, let me get started here. And I'll first write down two sort of last passage percolation problems. So the first one will be So right now I'm fairly general. I'll be in general dimension and with a fairly general setup that I'll describe soon, almost immediately. So there is a point-to-level last passage percolation problem. So I'll write it like this. It's going to be Gn of h, and it'll be a maximum over paths x dot subject to the condition of starting at the origin of zd. I'm going to be on the integer lattice all the time, no more exotic lattices than that. And we'll collect weight along the path stipulated by a function v. So along the path we will translate an underlying configuration omega of weight, so an environment configuration. And this v function can also depend on the next step of the walk. I'll explain this notation in just a moment, but I know that many of you know this kind of stuff inside out, so I thought I would start with these statements here. And we'll go n steps along the way. And then we'll further reward or penalize the path with this external field parameter h, so h dot xn. So maximizing over that thing there. So the maximum is over admissible paths. Is this writing too small? Okay, be sure to alert me if it is. And h here is a vector from Rd. So that's the point-to-level problem.
Can you explain the z?
Z, as Eric says, is the step of the path. Okay. So I'm not explaining all the notation yet, but that'll come on the next panel. And then there is the corresponding point-to-point last passage percolation problem. I'll write that. And it'll be a sort of a restricted path length problem. So if you give me two points, x and y, and an n, an integer, so g x n y is the maximum of the weight collected along a path that goes from x to y in n steps, okay? All right, so point to line and a point to level and a point to point last passage percolation problem. Yes?
Admissible here means one level at a time?
Yeah, I'll tell you what that means now. So again, those of you who know this game may wonder why in the point-to-point problem am I restricting the number of steps of the path? Well, I'm being a little bit more general here than the typical corner growth model where there's a unique number of steps between any two points. So here's the setting. So omega is a collection of iid weights indexed by the d-dimensional integer lattice. And there's a probability measure behind there. Admissible paths are defined by a set of admissible steps. That's going to be script R. So it's a finite. Let's write it the other way around. It's a finite subset of the lattice. At this point, fairly general. So this is the set of admissible steps. So a path is admissible if it takes its steps from that set R. And I'll assume that we are in a directed setting. It's not really necessary for what I say, but since that's the KPZ setting anyway, let's put ourselves in that setting. And saying so at this point already saves me the trouble of enunciating certain technicalities along the way. So by directed, I mean the following, that the origin is not in the convex hull of R, which I denote by script U. Okay, so you have the set of steps. Script U is the convex hull in RD. So I'm in a directed setting if the origin is not in that convex hull. Then I'm always forced to go into some direction, right? Okay. Let's see what else to say. Oh, yeah. V is then a function from environments cross steps, right? So cap omega is the space of these lowercase omegas. And two assumptions on that. It's local as a function of omega. So that means it only looks at some finite neighborhood of these weights omega. And I'll make a moment assumption on it.
It looks at finding many of the omega axes.
Yeah. So it looks at finitely many coordinates. Yeah. Did I say that wrong, maybe?
Well, I didn't.
I could have said it wrong, since the brain is always at a different place than the vocal organs, right, as you're talking. So it's local in omega, and I'll make a moment assumption that there is d plus epsilon moments. So there exists a little p bigger than d, such that the pth moment of V is finite. Okay. And let's see, have I said enough about the setting to satisfy everybody? Does somebody see if I'm missing something? So
what?
Sorry?
Theta
is the shift, yes, thank you. So on this space omega here, yeah, theta x of omega at point y is omega at x plus y. Yeah, that's the shift. And the example, so if you are somewhat newer to this this game, then just think of the following example, which is the two-dimensional corner growth model. So dimension is 2, the set of admissible steps is e1 and e2, the two basis vectors. Okay, and the v thing is just the weight at the origin. So that's the two-dimensional corner growth model. It's kind of convenient to let the v also depend on the z for various reasons. Including, for example, the one that in this formulation you can also handle edge weights simultaneously. So if you wanted your weights on the edges instead of the vertices, either directed edges or undirected. So in this case, if you wanted direct edges, your omegas would be weights on directed edges, then you could define your V like this and you would catch edge weights also. So it's a convenient setting. All right, so that is the setting. Can I clarify anything at this point? All right. So the next thing I'll state then, I'll take for granted the existence of the limits of those two last passage percolation problems. And my goal will be to describe those limits. So let's take this theorem we'll take for granted. It's been proved in various forms, of course, time and time again. So I'm basically just stating it to establish the notation for the sequel. So first, for the point to line, I guess I could do like this. The point to line problem, there exists a limiting function. So the random things are capital G's, and then the limiting deterministic things are lowercase g's. So let me write g sub L for the point-to-level, point-to-line thing. So there exists a function g sub L, a function of that h parameter up there, and it's deterministic. It's going to be convex. It's Lipschitz, and it's, of course, it's the law of large numbers limit for the point-to-level last passage percolation problem. Okay, so we'll take that for granted. So that's, of course, where, for example, where this moment assumption here comes in. And then for the point-to-point problem, similarly, there exists a function g sub p now for point-to-point from this set u to r, and it's deterministic, it's concave, and it's continuous all the way up to the boundary. That's, again, a consequence of this assumption here in the context of these other assumptions, so that g point to point of xi is the limit as n goes to infinity of 1 over n the g thing from the origin in n steps to a point n xc, and that's what I need to write there, where, again, p almost surely, where n xc in brackets just means a discrete approximation to n times xc picked intelligently so that it's reachable in n steps from the origin. Okay, so n xc brackets is a point on the lattice close to n times xc and reachable from the origin in n steps. Okay, so we have these laws of large numbers limits, and also for the sequel, let me point out that the two are connected by a convex duality, since I can write the point-to-level problem as a maximum over point-to-point problems, right? By taking a maximum over the endpoint. If you then take a limit of that, you get that the point-to-level thing is the supremum over these xi's, these admissible velocities in U of the point-to-point limit plus h dot xi. Okay, and that's sort of a convex-concave duality, so I can invert it. And write the point-to-point limit as the infimum over h's of the point-to-line limit minus h dot xi. Okay. All right. And let's say that C and H are dual, if the sup and the inf are realized, so if GPC equals GLH minus H dot C, and it is a fact that every C has a dual H. Well, okay, not if you take, you gotta take C in the relative interior of U. If you go on the edges, you might not have it. So for every C in the relative interior of U has a dual H. And you prove this by showing that the infimum here can be restricted to a compact set. This is not a terribly important point, but might be useful at some point in the sequel.
So this U has a certain dimension?
Thanks. Yeah, one could be general, but yeah, thanks. I did want to mention another assumption here. Let's assume that this script R here generates all of ZD as an additive group. If not, then some of the subsequent results would have to have be stated with that group. So, that doesn't quite actually answer your question, but it made me think of this assumption. Let's go to this example then in a moment. Let's see, what do the group theorists write? Do they do this? These brackets? So let me just say that the additive group generated by R is all of ZD. It doesn't have to be that way, but if it is, again, some statements simplify. So here, yeah, in this most important example, U is the line segment from E1 to E2, right? So here's the picture too, although I guess saying what I said is pretty clear. So script U is this little simplex here. And its relative interior, the open thing. Right. Questions so far? Okay. So that's we'll take that stuff for granted. And
limit is also finite.
Yeah. That's a good point. Yeah. If we relax some of these assumptions, then, for example, if I do non-directed, then I would have to start worrying about whether the limit is finite or not, because if I'm allowed to build loops with my path, then I can just go someplace where I have a big value and loop around there and things would blow up. So again, it's not really a problem, but I don't want to get into unnecessary complications. So indeed, okay, yeah, I guess I put it here that this is R-valued, yeah. So they are finite, and that's again, for those who know, for example, James Martin's 2004 paper, you know that this kind of an assumption guarantees the finite limits. It's not actually quite the optimal assumption, but close enough anyway. Yeah. Any other questions? Okay. I'm going to have to impose yet another somewhat abstract definition of you on you. So let's. Let's get that over with. So my goal is now to, for this lecture today, is to find some description for these limits, GL and GP. Right? So again, for those of you who are a little bit younger, these sorts of models go back to the mid-60s. 1965 is the year of first passage percolation from Hammersley and Welsh. And ever since, these the descriptions of these limiting shapes have remained a mystery in the subject, except for these exactly solvable cases. So what I'm going to show you are some still very, very abstract formulas, but formulas anyway, something other than just this limiting description for these shape functions here. But in order to do that, I need one more. I think I need just one more definition here. So I'm going to define a class of processes on that same omega space where the weights live, and we're calling them in our paper stationary cocycles. And I guess I should do some justice to my co-authors here also. So. Today's lecture is mostly a joint work with Nikos Georgiou, a former student of mine, who is now in Sussex, and Firas Rasul Aga at Utah. Okay, stationary cocycles. So let me write script K for the following space of processes. So these are functions, let me call capital B, no reference to Brownian motion intended, there won't be any Brownian motions in my talk. And we're formulating them like this. B takes three arguments. It takes an environment configuration from omega, and then two lattice points, and it satisfies the following sorts of conditions. Let's assume that it is integrable, and then it has a translation invariance. Let's say theta x omega u v is the same as, so going from u to v under a shifted omega is the same as going from x plus u to x plus v. And then an additivity going from x to y And then from y to z is the same as going from x to z. Okay. So these conditions for all omega, for almost all omegas, all lattice points. I think that's what I want. So that's space script k of stationary cocycles. And then I want also a notation for the mean zero members. So those f's in script k that have mean zero. Okay. So these are the spaces over which my variational formulas will be defined. And I need a couple of, okay, I want a notational convention here for the mean vector of B in the following sense. So for each B in that space script K, there's a vector H of B such that expectation of B0x is minus h of b dot x for all x's. So for some reason, well, I know the reason, but so we put a minus sign there. So this h of b is sort of minus the mean vector of b. And furthermore, if I have this, and then I define f of omega xy to be minus h of b dot y minus x minus b omega xy, then this is a member of k naught. So this is just our convention for the mean vector and the centering of a cocycle that's not mean zero. That's all. Right. Then there is an ergodic theorem.
The reason for this HB is because of linearity.
Yeah, yeah. So the mean there is an additive function on ZD. So if at this point if I didn't make this assumption here, I would be defining those cocycles not on ZD but on the group generated by R. So, and I want an ergodic theorem. It has a technical boundedness assumption, which I think in the interest of time I won't reproduce on the board. It's there in the notes. So under a technical boundedness assumption, the assumption will be valid in all the cases where I appeal to this theorem. If I take a mean zero cocycle, then it satisfies a uniform ergodic theorem, following type, limit maximum over x is not more than n away, and absolute f of omega 0 x divided by n is 0, p almost surely. And in the notes, I give a reference of where you can find this proved.
There's a condition on the weight.
There's a condition on the on f. Yeah, so the boundedness, okay, yeah. Actually, I guess it's good you asked because, yeah, I don't mean to imply that I have to impose a condition on the omegas. This boundedness assumption here is on f. Okay. Not on the weights omega. See, f is a function on omega, right? And the omegas underlying, it's just an IID field with the shifts. So ergodicity works there. But to get this uniformity, I need an assumption on it. So that's what I'm hiding here. Okay. All right, I think I have the setting in place now. Can I answer any questions at this point? Yeah, that's right. So I have a space of IID weights, you know, completely general. I build this percolation business on it. And then on the other hand, I define this space of functions whose gradient is shift invariant. And they will be connected then soon enough. Okay. Let's bring something down here. That's that. Okay, so let me now state the first theorem to be proved. So this is very elementary and short at this point, because we've been working at this for a couple years now. So I can actually prove these things completely to you, and there isn't much to it at all. So first I'll state a formula for the point-to-line limit, which is up there. So GL of H equals the following, infimum over mean zero cocycles, essential supremum over omega, and a maximum over admissible steps of the potential V omega Z plus H dot Z plus the F. So that's the formula for the point to level limit, and there is a minimizer one can establish abstractly. So there is exists a minimizing f in k zero. Oh, maybe one more word here. So perhaps it's helpful to say the following. That this space of mean zero things, which I denote by F usually, and the non-mean zero things I'll denote by B, these F things are the L1 closure of gradients. So K0 is the L1 closure of gradients. And by gradients, I mean something like this, you know, nabla phi omega xy, which is phi at omega shifted by y minus phi at omega shifted by x. And you can take phi bounded or L1. So this is the way that the k-naught guys arise. And this infimum here would be valid just as well for the gradients, but then I wouldn't know if there's a minimizing thing. So going to this space of cocycles is, from one perspective, just a natural closure operation, so that you have a minimizer. But it's more than that, because then when we go to the exactly solvable thing, I can actually construct the thing in K0, and it's a real concrete object. Okay, let me prove this theorem. Let me abbreviate for the proof. K of F, so K of F, let me just actually put it here so I don't have to spend time writing it. Let this here be K of F. Okay. All right. So the proof comes in two parts, an upper bound and a lower bound. So let me start with upper bound. Okay, so what do I need to prove? I want to show that. So I want to show that the limit G sub L is less than or equal to K of F for any F that I choose from the mean zero cocycles, right? So since that's what I want to show, I might as well assume that K of F is finite, right? If it's not finite, then there's nothing to prove. So this assumption here is strong enough to let this ergodic theorem kick in. So that hidden boundedness assumption is something that follows from this assumption. Okay. So the ergodic theorem is valid for this F. So I can use this. All right. So let's do just three, four lines of calculation here. So GL of H is, by definition, the limit. I'm just going to copy now basically what's up there. It's the limit of the max over paths of 1 over n. Okay, I guess I'm putting the 1 over n outside. Doesn't matter. Summation v theta xk of omega z k plus 1. K goes from 0 to n minus 1 plus the h dot xn, right? This is the definition. But now, on account of this ergodic theorem here, I can put that capital F also inside the braces, right? So I can add here F of omega 0 xn, right? Because uniformly in this position xn, the F divided by n goes to 0, right? Is everybody okay with that? Uniformly, see, at first it's like this. The F is not there, that's the definition. But since the F uniformly in its xn, when divided by n goes to 0, almost surely in omega, I can slip that inside. And now I'm almost home free, because all I need to do is to observe that this is the same as limit of maximum limit of maximum of the paths 1 over n summation. In this next step, I'm just going to split this term into a sum of increments and this term into a sum of increments, which I can because it's one of those cocycle things and they have that additivity property. So this is v of theta xk omega zk plus 1. So my z's are all the time. Did I put that down anywhere? I did, yeah. My z's are all the time the steps of the x path. So here it's h dot zk plus 1. And here it's f of theta xk omega 0 zk plus 1, like this. And now, by virtue of this definition here, each of these terms is now almost surely less than or equal to k of f. Okay. So this quantity here is just this quantity here evaluated at the shifted omega. So then if I'm taking S sup and max, then of course this brackets expression is bounded above by that k of f. Because k of f just says take S sup of omega and max over the step z. So there's n terms, divide by n, so we're done, right? So this is less than or equal to k of f. So the upper bound is proved, right? Is that everybody okay with that? As I said, there's hardly anything to it. This is all very elementary. I should say that this stuff was not born quite this way, if you permit a few moments of history. So a number of years ago, Firas and I were working on large deviations for random walk in random environment. At some point, we made the step of including polymers in our studies. So we proved large deviation principles for polymers. So that's the positive temperature counterpart of these models that Francis will talk about tomorrow. And we got certain formulas. And once we had formulas for positive temperature, then we thought, well, let's take a zero temperature limit and see if we can get something interesting for percolation models. So that's how these formulas came about first, through this very circuitous route. And then afterwards, we began to look for simpler proofs. So that's what I'm showing you here now. Okay, lower bound proof. So now I want the reverse inequality there. So let me take a number lambda that's bigger than the limit, and then define the following function. Let un of omega be the exponential of g, capital G and h, so that's the last passage thing itself, minus n times lambda. Okay. Since lambda is bigger than the limit, right, this is eventually exponentially decaying, right? So it's eventually less than e to the minus epsilon n for some positive epsilon, almost surely. So I can add up the un's over the n. No harm there, right? So if I define this function f of omega as summation n goes from 0 to infinity un of omega, it's a completely safe thing, at least for almost every fixed omega. It's a finite thing. Okay, this is for what is if n is 0? If n is 0, just take it equal to 1. Okay, and now I'll play with this summation here a little bit. I'll separate out the first term, that's the 1, and I'll write explicitly the maximum here. So this is the exponential of the max over paths x dot. So at first I'm just copying old stuff here. But now let me separate out the first step. So the first step is this x1 here. What do I want? Minus lambda. And then the rest. So these are the terms for the first step. And then I'll take the rest. So that'll be k goes from 1 to n minus 1. Theta xk omega zk plus 1 plus h dot xn minus x1 minus n minus 1 times lambda. Okay. So there I didn't do anything but reproduce the definition and separate out the first terms. So now I'll bound this from below by doing two things. I'll drop this one from here, and I'll take this part outside. So I'll take the summation inside. So I'll take this part outside with a maximum over the first step, and then I'll take the summation inside. So I'm going to make it, if anything, smaller. So then it'll look like this. Max over the first step z of e to the this first stuff here, v of omega z plus h dot z minus lambda. And then the summation goes inside. And now if you look at what you have here, you have the last passage thing. So this g, not with n, but with n minus 1, and also the n minus 1 lambda, not at omega, but at the shifted omega. So this stuff here inside the sum is now un minus 1 at the shifted omega. Okay. So this x1 here, this x1 here became a z in this next step. Okay. So again, if you're quick at sorting out notation in your head, there's nothing there, basically, except that I drop the one and I put the sum a little bit inside the maximum to make it smaller. So now I have this, and this thing here I'll rewrite as f of theta z omega. Let's see if I can, let me make some room here for myself. So that's an f of theta z, oh sorry, it's a, yeah, it's an f of theta z omega. So now I'll rewrite the whole thing as follows. I'll, let's see if I can do this in just one swoop. I'll take this minus lambda to the other side of the inequality. I'll take this f to this side and take a logarithm of both sides. And let's see if you can agree that the lambda on the left-hand side is bigger than or equal to v omega z plus h dot z plus log, let's see if I'm doing this right, yeah, log f of, oops, there is the maximum over z, which I forgot, which of course I want there very desperately, max over z of v omega z plus h dot z plus log f of shifted omega minus log f of omega, right? So this was just a matter of moving stuff around in the inequality. And well, this thing here is exactly k of the gradient of log f. Okay. Just by definition, right? It's k of the...
There's no super
omega. Oh, yeah, right. So, aha, yeah. Thank you, Eric, yeah. So this is valid for almost every omega that I'm doing here. So I can stick an S sup here. Thanks. Very glad that somebody is sharp here. So we'll stick an S sup here. I guess Daniel, let me see if I left that out from my notes. Yeah, it's there, but it's done slower. Okay. So this inequality here would have been true almost surely. So hence I can stick the S sup there. So this is exactly k of the gradient of this function log f. And this would be then less than or equal to the infimum over k of capital F for capital F's in the k-naught space. If I would know that this is integrable. Okay. And I do know that it is a consequence of this inequality here, the ergodic theorem, and the assumption on V. Okay. So again, it's spelled out in the notes. So it's nothing much again, but just that the observation that this upper bound here, see, if you were worried about the integrability of this nabla log f here, then this upper bound here would give you the integrability of the positive part. You use the ergodic theorem to nail down the integrability of the negative part, and that's it, okay? So this is true. So then we can go even lower with an infimum, right? And then I let my lambda in the end go down to this g L of h. And lower bound is proved us. Okay.
You sum from any zero, it's irrelevant, I guess. You're looking at a different zone.
Yeah, let's see.
You also cancel the one.
Yeah, I dropped the one. Yeah, why did I sum from zero? I don't know. It's true. What if I had just summed from one? Then that wouldn't be there. Would I have an extra term here? I guess not. Or would I? Not sure. Yeah, I can't do math on my feet in front of an audience, so there's no way I could decide now. Okay, any other questions? Okay, so that's the variational formula for the point-to-line version. Let's see, how am I doing with time? Okay, I'm doing great, actually. I think we can even stop early today. So then let me deduce from this a variational formula for the point-to-point version. Oops, no, I probably didn't want to do that, but I wanted to do this. Let's see. Maybe I want to leave this formula up for a moment and just put the point-to-point theorem next to it. Okay. So, point to point. So here x is, yeah. I better take c in the relative interior of u, because when x goes to the extremes, then funny stuff might happen. So it doesn't matter much, but anyway. So now I take infimum of cocycles B that are not mean zero, otherwise the same. Almost. And then here, well, again, just because of the way our conventions go, I put a minus sign there. And then I think I put a minus sign here, like this. I think that's the way we write it. Yes, okay. How is this proved? Well, let me not do the details, but you start from that duality there. So you write g peak c equals infimum over h's of GL of H minus H dot C. And then you substitute in here this formula. Let's put a double dagger there. So you substitute double dagger for the GLH here, and then you just mess around with it a little bit. So here it's over mean zero f's, but there's an h, so now you interpret this together as a cocycle, so h is the mean of that cocycle, and then when you look at it for a little bit, this stuff emerges, right, etc. So that's the proof of the point-to-point formula. So again, it's just a three lines of calculation, and it's in the notes there. Okay. So that's the proof of the variational formulas. Any questions I could clarify at this point? So now actually, I'll go back to Daniel's question some time ago, was very prescient. So we have these two things now, the percolation and these stationary cocycles on the same space. Is there any natural condition that would connect the two? And of course, these formulas connect the two, but something a little more transparent. So, as the last thing, at least for this segment of the talk, I'll describe a local connection that connects the potential V and those cocycles B that then leads to finding minimizing cocycles and some other stuff. So let me actually use this board behind here now for a while.
So far you haven't constructed minimizing one.
No, I haven't. Yeah, that's right. That's right. So I'm going to give now a local condition that gives us minimizing cocycles and gives us a bunch of other things too. And then in the subsequent lectures, when we go to the exponential case, then I can sort of flesh all this abstract stuff out. We will be able to calculate. Yes, Mihai. Yeah, that's right. So, yes, that's true. That is exactly true. So here, one can say that there exists a minimizing B such that H of B is dual to C. Yes, thanks for asking. Yeah. And this is one reason why we actually put the minus sign over there, so that here we wouldn't have to say minus H of B is dual, but the duality is naturally between H and C. Yeah. Any other questions? Yes, Arjun.
So the grand log F, are the minimizing?
Say again, sorry.
So you have the gradient of logarithm of F, right?
Yeah. Well, let's see, do I still have it? I guess it's gone now.
It's here.
I guess it's here. I don't know that, I mean, this thing might blow up. So for each lambda, right, we have one of these Fs. Maybe under some circumstances one could prove that you could then take lambda down to, I don't know. But yeah, that may be something that perhaps should be investigated. Okay. Yeah, so perhaps parlaying these couple of questions into some remarks. So first of all, there are positive temperature versions of these formulas. Maybe if I have time in the end, I'll write down what those are also. So for the polymers. So then one asks, okay, in what settings can we write down explicitly these minimizers? Just in a few. In the exactly solvable cases, yes. For polymers in weak disorder, if you know what that means, again, yes, easy. And then for periodic environments. So then you are basically in a finite environment space case. It doesn't satisfy my IID hypothesis, but this whole framework is true much in complete generality, essentially. Ergodic environments.
You haven't used it all, IID
properties. Yeah, have I used?
Well,
I guess not. Well, I guess I used it in the existence theorem.
Yeah.
But these formulas are true even if the limit is not finite. The existence theorem is true, again, much more generally, as you can imagine. What is needed then, if you want to generalize from IID, then what is needed is more moments here. So the whole picture works under a hypothesis where you can trade mixing of P for moments in V. So an extreme case would be where you assume nothing of P except ergodicity. Well, in that case, you'd have to have a bounded V in general. And then the more mixing you give P, the less stringent you have to be on V. It's in a paper that Firas and I published in PTRF a few years ago where that theorem up there is stated fairly generally under such hypotheses. So. All right, where was I going? Oh yeah, the local condition. So let's make it sort of a semi-formal definition here. Let's say that cocycle B is adapted to this potential V if max over admissible steps of V omega Z minus B omega zero Z is zero almost surely. Okay. So condition looks a little bit odd at first, I admit, but it turns out to be extremely fruitful, simple as it is. So what is it good for? It connects with four different things. So the first thing is that, so let's call this condition star. So first of all, if B satisfies star, then B is a minimizer in both of those formulas for the appropriately chosen H and C. So B minimizes in the formulas, in the variational formulas. The second thing is that not only is B connected to this sort of global or macroscopic optimum, it's also connected to local pathwise optimum, namely geodesics. So where is my, there's my point-to-point problem. So we could say, this is of course somewhat bad language because we don't have a metric and we are taking maximum, but we could say that a path x dot is a geodesic if all the segments of the path give the maximum of this sum between its endpoints, right? So maybe geometers would not like us to use this term, but it's good, right? So it turns out that if you have this condition star, then B gives a local way of constructing geodesics. So I don't think I have time to clarify all these four points that I'm making here, so then you can look in the notes if you're interested. By local way, I mean that a geodesic can be a very, very big thing. But when you have a cocycle that satisfies this property, you can construct a geodesic step by step simply by enforcing that this, by choosing that step which makes this equal to zero. That will give you a geodesic if you just follow that rule step by step. Okay? Sorry? Well, at least in the directed case, not. Yeah, right. But yeah, it's true that more generally, one would have to worry about those kinds of things too.
So are you trying to say that the geodesic, I mean, of course, it's defined by a global property, but also by a local differential?
Yeah, property. That's right.
So kind of the local differential property.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. No, it doesn't have to be. That's right. So now we get to the question of when geodesics are unique. So if we put a continuous distribution on our weights, we would have unique geodesics. If not, geodesics are not unique, and then following any path that satisfies this would give you a geodesic between its endpoints. Yeah. So. These two points already convinced us that this is really valuable. How does one find a cocycle that satisfies this? Well, that's where the Busemann limits come in. If you have a Busemann limit, then this will give a cocycle B that satisfies this star condition. So I haven't defined yet what Busemann limits is. Maybe I have a chance to do it in a moment. If not, it'll come next time. But that, of course, is a very difficult limit to prove, right? Very, very hard. So it's not necessarily a good recipe for finding a B. But if we think a little bit of the analogy with a Markov process or a Markov chain, now if you want to say something about the limit distribution of a Markov process, you usually don't try to take the limit. Instead, you would solve for a stationary distribution. So the same works here. So this condition is also connected to a stationary last passage percolation process. So that'll be the route that we will then take in the next talk for finding a cocycle that satisfies this property. It's by solving for a stationary distribution. Okay, so now I have some time left, so let me clarify these points one by one, maybe starting with this first one here, since we've been talking about the variational formulas.
But this last point, you can do it in particular cases, right? Or in general?
Well, I can show this condition very generally, so let me see what to erase now. I don't want to... I can erase that last board there. I want to keep the variational formulas.
You just listed cases where you can construct with
tables. Yeah, that's right. But I can show you this condition, not condition, this connection in a sort of a general way. But to actually find them, yes. To actually find them, then which one is which? Yeah, that one. To actually find them, yeah, then I would have to go to the exactly solvable case. Yeah. Okay, I guess that's pretty good. Okay, let me use this board here. So let me first show you why this condition leads to minimizing cocycles. Again, it seems mysterious, but once I write down what's going on, you'll see that it's rather elementary, actually. Okay. So suppose I have a cocycle B that satisfies star. And I'll first construct the minimizer for the point-to-level problem. So then I will do this here. I'll define a mean zero cocycle exactly like this. And then star gives me the following, that I'm just rewriting it here with the F, max over the steps of B omega z plus hb dot z plus f. Okay, so I didn't do anything again except just define f like this in terms of B and then replace B with minus h of B minus f. Okay, but so this is now an almost sure equality, so I can iterate it. So I can start building a path. At each step, I have this equality. So then I have it for the path, right? Like this. And now I'll divide by n. And I wish to apply the ergodic theorem again to this f. Why can I do it? Well, this condition here is again good enough to verify the technical assumption that's been hidden here. So the uniform ergodic theorem works once again. So this portion here will just simply go away as n goes to infinity. And this other portion here, well, that's just 1 over n times the point-to-level last passage percolation problem, right, with h of b there. So then when I take a limit, this goes to little g l of h, right? Oops, h of b. Okay, but there it is basically, because look, now, so let me put it here. So g l of h is zero, as I just showed, but this here is also zero. So they are the same, almost surely, in fact. Okay. So I don't even need the S sup there, because this quantity here is almost surely equal to zero. So F minimizes for G L H of B. Sort of almost in a trivial manner. Okay. Along the way here, we get a lemma, which I think, depending on what I say later on, I might use. So let me separate it here. That if B satisfies this condition star, then GL of H of B is zero. So that might come in handy later. And similarly, let me not do this. Similarly, if xi is dual to h of b, then this b minimizes the variational formula over there for the point-to-point case.
Okay. But so you can only find minimizers for h such that GLH is zero.
No, not quite. You can, I mean, well, in this general setting, yeah, I can't do much. But once I'm in a more specific setting, I'm merely illustrating here that if we have that condition, we can get started with finding minimizers. So then to find them for all the other h's, I would, a general H, if a general H satisfies for some H of B so that it's orthogonal to the affine hull of R, then that same B minimizes for that too, but the value is not zero. So all the H's, again, in the ideal case, will sort of, the entire space of H's will split into a disjoint union of H's that satisfy this condition for different Busemann functions indexed by the directions. So this duality between H and Xi, it's not one-to-one on this side, but there's a whole line of H's. So all those H's on one of those lines will be dual to a particular xi, and for them, the minimizing b is the Busemann function in that direction xi. So that's the underlying picture. But here I just wanted to point out that this condition naturally leads to minimizing b's. Okay, so that's the first point up there. Let me next do the Busemann thing. And I think I can safely erase out over here now. So suppose now we're in the nicer special case where the set of admissible steps is such that each admissible path between two points, say x and y, that each admissible path, between x and y has the same number of steps. So for example, if you're in the two-dimensional corner growth model, or more general, the d-dimensional. So then I can drop this silly n here, and just take that n, which gives the number of steps between x and y. So then a Busemann function, well, I guess one of the ways that Busemann functions are defined, I guess it's beginning to be a little bit diverse in the literature, perhaps. So a Busemann function is the following limit. Let me copy how I did it in the notes exactly. Okay, b omega xy equals limit as n goes to infinity of a local increment of these last passage values. So gx, vn minus gy, vn. And again, I'm not making any precise statements, but let's suppose we have this limit almost surely whenever vn over its little L1 norm converges to some in some direction xi for some given xi. Just suppose that we would have this limit. So you can see this is a very difficult limit because there is no normalization. Okay. But suppose we have that. So then I just want to point out that if we have that thing, then that condition star follows. So then star follows, and again, it's just immediate, because if I write max over z, d omega z plus b omega zero z, and then put the substitute in there, the limit, minus, okay, v omega z minus g zero v n plus g z v n, and then just observe that this last passage value here is exactly equal to the maximum of the possible first steps. And then doing the last passage from there onwards. So this is just zero immediately. Okay. Oops, I forgot the max from there. I guess I could put it outside here. Doesn't either way. But anyway, you can take this thing outside and then I'm just trying to show that if I have this limit, then directly from the definitions, condition star follows. That's all. That's all. Just a
you're saying you take the first step, but isn't it the last step? Because they end up at the same point?
So say Vn is up there, zero is here. So z is an allowable step. So z is one of those, right? So then I could imagine, yeah, so I can, so then the maximal thing from zero to vn is maximum over the first step of the weight at the first, oops, not, yeah. The first weight plus the remaining last passage. So I'm just doing the induction from here and not from there. Okay. So the lesson of this was just that Busemann functions are naturally connected with that connection star, but that's a hard limit to prove. And I think what we'll see in Eric's and my talks are two different ways of approaching that limit. So for that, as a last thing, so then let me then say a word about the stationary last passage percolation process. So lastly, a few words about the stationary last passage percolation. So I'll start again with condition star there. And now I'll develop it into a slightly different thing. So it says, let's put the zero there. Zero equals max over z. So now let me do it at a shifted omega, theta u of omega, minus b theta u of omega, zero z, like this. Well, by the rules of cocycles, this is the same as b of omega u to u plus z, and furthermore, this is equal to b of omega, let me see just clearly what I want to write here, b from u to v, and minus, let's see if I'm getting this right, u to v, u to u plus z, comma v, like that. So now if I take the b omega uv outside, that is equal to max over a step z of v theta u omega comma z, and I forgot the z here, sorry. Now plus, because this minus here becomes a plus, b omega u plus z v, okay? So v and u are anything now. But now I can iterate this formula. So I have a formula for b omega u v. It's like this. Take one step z from u, and then take your cocycle from that next place to u to v. And then I iterate, apply the same formula to this. And I do many times over. Every time I pick up a maximum over a path, so after a while, I mean over a step, so after a while I have n steps, and I'm developing a sum over these potential values. So let xk be the sum of the z's. And, I'm starting my path at u, so let xk be u plus the steps. So then it's like this, theta xk of omega, zk plus 1, k goes from 0 to n minus 1, plus b of omega xn v, okay? So you see the point-to-point last passage thing is developing here. So I could write this as a maximum over just the last step, xn. So maximum over, say, x, maximum over x. such that x is n steps from u, and g from u to x plus b of omega xv. Okay, so I get this sort of a connection between the two, and out of this I could write down a boundary value problem. So let me finish with that, because that then points the way to Wednesday's lecture. So from this, a boundary value problem. So, for example, imagine this picture. Take a rectangle in the lattice, call it script H. Imagine now that all the paths sort of go upwards and to the right. So, and then take a boundary here, call it DH. The condition being that every admissible path from H has to hit the boundary eventually. And maybe I could put my V in that corner there. So then the following is true, that for every U in H, B omega U V is equal to the maximum of over X on the boundary of the point-to-point last passage from u to x, so this part here, plus the b guy from x to v. So, in other words, this is a starting point for trying to find a nice b. The idea is that b is given on this boundary here, and then from this formula I can solve for b in the interior here. And now, if I'm really lucky, perhaps I can choose the random b's here on this boundary in such a way that their distribution is preserved into the bulk. So this way I could find I could regard b as a stationary last passage percolation process. And then if I'm really, really lucky, maybe I can do this all explicitly, and that we can do in the exactly solvable cases. And this connects now nicely with Kostya's lecture, right? Because this here is nothing but a discrete sort of hop flux Olynyk formula, if you want to think of it that way. And of course, one could take limits of it and then get Hamilton-Jacobi equations in the limit as hydrodynamic limits. If one then took continuum limits, one could get a Hamilton-Jacobi equation. Okay, perfect place to stop. So thanks very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. It's just right time, by the way. We're not short in time, but any questions?
Yes. Oh, just a moment.
So, just a simple question, but can you compute these things in, for instance, I don't know, in if you took, say, the corner growth modeling, I guess you can get the parabola there.
Yeah, right? With the exponential, yeah. So in the exactly solvable cases, yeah, we can. We can give some explicit descriptions of these objects. Yeah.
So if you didn't take exponential, but you took something different?
No, not yet. No.
Any other questions?
When I have a remark, sure.
Well, it's only a remark of an analogy. I mean, when you put it like that, no, in the theorem, so the left part is kind of the average action. It's kind, no, you see the action over here, I mean, of the action and the minimizers, and then over n it's kind of large average. And then in the Hamiltonian setting or the Aubrey matter theory, that's called the effective Hamiltonian. No one has an H there. And then there is also a theorem that looks like that, that the effective Hamiltonian, it is like a min-max formula of subsolutions of the Hamilton-Jacobi equation. So, I mean, it just...
Exactly true, yeah. Man.
Thanks. Yeah,
it's homogenization kind of.
Yeah, this problem is very close to homogenization, and it's one of my faults, one of many, that I have not educated myself enough about homogenization to be able to put this in the right context and make the right connections.
Yeah, there are a lot of connections with this adapted stuff you're doing with what Fatih was doing, and also this cocycles, not minimizing cases, but cocycles, they probably just sub-solutions. And then the minimizing one is a solution.
Mm-hmm. It should all be really, really related to that.
There
context.
Is a connection.
But
that's exactly what we want to understand here: these different connections and what we can do with it. And if there are no, or maybe there are other questions, we have plenty of time, by the way. No further lectures. Okay, but we'll have more opportunities to ask them. Thank you very much.
Thanks.